It's my honour and privilege to introduce our next speaker, who has taken time out of her busy life in Wellington to come and talk to us, Nat Dudley.
Technically, I'm from Auckland, but you know, New Zealand, Auckland, Wellington, same difference, right? So tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. I'm Nat, and unlike basically everybody at this conference, I'm a designer. So I'm head of design for an organisation called Figure NZ, and we work to make data about New Zealand open and available for everyone to use. So if you're an open data nerd, come and find me and chat. It's like my favourite topic in the world to talk about. But I'm not talking about open data today. I'm talking about knitting and code. Now, if you were in Chris's talk on Monday, you might know some of the backstory to some of this stuff already, so bear with me because I'm going to explain some of it again. But for everybody else, imagine it's the 1940s and you are in occupied Belgium. So the Nazis are everywhere at this stage and you're not real happy about this. If you're wondering what that feels like, kind of think about what it's like to be in the States right now, perhaps. So you live next to a railway yard and the Nazis use it to move troops and supplies around. So they're not suspicious of you right now. And you realize that you could use this to your advantage. You want to find a way to record the trains that are moving around the yard and get that information into the Belgian resistance so that they can use it to plan. But obviously you don't really want to get caught. So how would you get the code out to them? So if you answered knit it, you'd be right. So the elderly woman in Belgium who lived above the train tracks, they sat and watched the train movements every day, and as they did it, they sat and did their knitting, and they changed their stitch pattern as they knitted along, a different stitch for each type of train movement. And then they took those knitted things and they sent them to the Belgian resistance, and they used those to understand what was going on in the trains. So up until now, if you heard the words knitting and World War II, you probably thought of this, right? We all know about the old ladies and the young ladies and even the school kids who knit socks and other things to send out to the war front. But what you might not know is that in World War II it was actually illegal to send knitting patterns by post in case they contained coded messages. So knitting is at its core binary code. It's made up of two stitches. We've got a knit stitch and we have a purl stitch. And those two stitches are the exact opposite of one another. So if you flip a piece made of knit stitch over, it's going to look like purl stitch and vice versa. So they're exact inverses. And so in modern knitting, lots and lots of knitters take nerdy inspiration from this, and they knit all sorts of codes into their craft. So Chris's talk went through a whole bunch of these. There's ones where people actually knit like binary strings into it. There's ones where they knit literal ones and zeros. There's ones where people knit nerdy patterns. There's all sorts of stuff that happens. But early programmers took a more literal inspiration. So if you're not familiar with what this is a Jacquard loom, and it was created by Joseph Marie Jacquard. So Jacquard looms are created to weave complex fabric patterns. And before the Jacquard loom, an experienced team of weavers, so not one weaver, a whole team of them, could weave about 1 inch of complex pattern fabric a day. So not especially efficient. So to help speed up this process, in 1803, so well before Babbage or any of the programming stuff came around, punch cards were invented to encode the positions of the warp and the weft, and those are the thread positions that you use in weaving. And the punch cards told the loom whether the position of the warp should be above or below the weft. Again, it's a basic binary code, right? Do I go up or down? And it encoded that for every single string along the loom. Now, if you know your computer science history, you'll probably know about Ada Lovelace, mentioned in the title of the talk. She's considered to be the first programmer for the work that she did on Charles Babbage's analytical engine. And she drew inspiration from the Jacquard loom. So this is what she said. So in her writing about the analytical engine, she said, "We may say most aptly that the analytical engine weaves algebraic patterns, just as the Jacquard loom weaves flowers and leaves." So the punch card systems that were used to enable the many different patterns to be woven efficiently on the loom became the inspiration for the Hollerith tabulating machine. Now the Hollerith tabulating machine was used for the US Census, and they used it for the US Census when the amount of results that they needed to calculate would take longer to count by hand than the period between the census. Kind of a problem. So the Hollow Earth tabulating machine went on in turn to become the foundation for international business machines, which are better known as IBM. So this loom and fibercraft became the foundation for a lot of modern computing practice. So if you know your craft, you know that weaving is not knitting, although it is often done with the same fibers. But both of them are binary and both of them are fiber-based crafts. And also, if you talk about craft and you talk about code and you don't mention the Jacquard loom, you will always have someone come up to you afterwards and be like, oh my gosh, do you know about the Jacquard loom? So we're just getting that out of the way, right? So back to knitting. So knitting's been around for about 1,000 years, depending on what source you believe. So these cotton socks were found in Egypt, and they're believed to be some of the earliest knitted pieces from around about 1,000 to 1300 AD. And you can see that they're pretty complicated already. There's color work with repeating patterns, and there's a lack of seaming that suggests that this is already reasonably advanced in terms of knitting craft. So what does this have to do with code? And more specifically, what does it have to do with open source code? So you can think about a finished garment that most of you will have in terms of knitted things. You can think about that as what you buy in a store as closed source, right? So you could deconstruct it to figure it out. It's a bit of a pain, it's hard work. And instead, hand knitters use patterns to share code amongst ourselves. And that enables us to all construct our own copies of what we're creating. And now you can go old school and you can get these patterns out of books, or you can be like most modern knitters, and we use a code repository called Ravelry. So Ravelry is, amongst other things, a website used to find and download patterns to knit and to crochet. And there's about 6.8 million knitters across the world using Ravelry. So for comparison, as of about December 4th when I checked, there's 24 million users on GitHub, so you've got about one knitter for every four GitHubers. So in terms of scale, this is a pretty big community. And this is our code. So if you look closely, you'll probably see familiar patterns. There are conditionals, there are while loops, there are functions. You know, a lot of the familiar things you see in programming, you're also going to see in knitting patterns. Like the very start, right? You've got, for the small size, follow these instructions. For the large size, work to row 27, then work a wrong side row, then work to section 3. Right? If you're not recognizing like if-else statements in some of this stuff, probably want to look a little closer. And here's what that code looks like compiled. I have an example of it in real life in my bag. You can come and have a look. And while many knitters probably wouldn't recognize it, the knitting community functions like other open source communities. So when we get a pattern and they have bugs in them, we often report those bugs back to the designers and we suggest fixes to them. And they're often things we've figured out as we're knitting them. The designers, in turn, update their pattern and they push an update out through Ravelry with a new version and with release notes. Right? Same as open source code works. But more than that, the ability to build on and modify the code is core to the knitting process. So each knitter makes decisions that impact the final finished product. So we choose everything from the needle type, the yarn, and that includes things like colors and weights and the type of fibers that they're made up of. And the nature of those fibers, so are they washable, are they synthetic, are they like silk where they're really slippery. So we think about all of that when we are making a project. Some of us are literal yak shavers, right? We actually go and find the animals, get the fiber off the animal, wash it, process it, spin it, turn it into yarn, and then knit that. You know, you talk about yak shavers, we're real good at it. And the most skilled knitters, in fact, you know, most knitters who are anything past basic level, are also modifying patterns as they knit, and they share those variations back to the community. So not just as patches back to the actual project if it's a bug, they'll actually vary the pattern themselves, and when they share their finished project back onto Ravelry, they'll tell you what the variations are. So this person added in extra sections to it, they changed the type of decreases that they do, and they used a different type of yarn, and they've shared what they've done and their learnings back with the community. Now, when I knitted this project, I found this and I was like, awesome, that looks really cool. I'm gonna do their version of it. All right, so we were doing CC BY before CC BY was even really a thing. So all of this started me wondering, right? So if knitting is like code, and code is like knitting, and like the Belgian underground and Ada Lovelace and all of those people learned from knitting, is there still stuff that we can learn from it today? And so I started learning both knitting and coding about 4 years ago as a New Year's resolution. Now, as a designer, I am probably the world's worst front-end developer. Please do not ask me to write front-end code for you. You will hate it. But nonetheless, learning both of them at the same time, it was really interesting for me to observe the similarities and differences between our communities. And I'm going to talk to you about four things that I observed that I think that knitting does really, really well that I think coding could learn from. So the first one is that if you want your community to last, you have to make it welcoming. So I started out, as I said, as a newbie in both communities at the same time, and it was eye-opening. Both communities, in theory, want new people to engage and succeed. Knitters, because we want our craft to stay alive. You are not a knitter if you don't have people coming up to you being like, oh, knitting's a dead craft, why are you still knitting? Why don't you just go buy a jumper? And we're like, seriously? And coders, because we really want more talent in our industry, and particularly in open source, we really want people to help us to deliver on the open source principles, right? So we want more people to engage in what we do. But the way that we go about this is really different. So when I started knitting, it was incredibly overwhelming. There was an entire language that I didn't speak. There were new tools, new materials, there was this pattern code stuff that I didn't know how to speak. I didn't know where to start, right? Do you start a project? Which project do you pick? Like, what needles do you buy? What wool do you buy? It's all foreign. And so, like most millennials, I turned to Twitter, and I cried basically, help! Also, just notice that Twitter is telling me to follow Trump. Please do better, Twitter. That's not a happening thing. But within minutes, right, of that tweet, I had replies back from literally dozens of knitters. People retweeted it, and I had been introduced to Ravelry, which I'd never heard of. I had solid suggestions of really good patterns for a beginner to start with. I had links to YouTube videos to teach me how to cast on and do basic stitches. I had guidance about what needles to buy that were good for beginners, because there is a difference about ones that are good for beginners and good for experienced people. I had a basic primer on what the heck the difference between sport weight and DK and worsted and fingering and light fingering and all the other weirdness was. There were even Instagram hashtags for me to follow, right, that taught me how to do basic things. I could see how other people did their craft. And I also had an invitation to a local knitting group. And they were more than happy to welcome some rando stranger off the internet into their midst and to help me get started. And members of this group throughout my time learning patiently helped me to debug the many, many, many mistakes that I made as I started on my knitting journey. So the message I got over and over again from all parts of the community was, you can do this. You belong here, right? You can be one of us. We want you to be part of this. And so when I finished my first project, it was a pair of socks, and I nervously shared a photo on Twitter, and I posted my project on Ravelry, the community cheered me on. And I'm going to be honest with you, they were not great socks. Like, first knitting projects, never really that great. They were uneven stitches, the color choice was highly questionable. But it didn't matter, right? The community knew that that was not the time to critique me. The time that I was being really vulnerable and going, here is this really ugly baby that I've made. They knew that that was not the time to be like, you made the wrong decision, your code is bad, right? That was the time for celebration and for support. Self-doubt and frustration will turn newbies away from any skill, but building a welcoming community can help you to mitigate that. So as I said, people keep saying knitting's a dying craft, but it survived for over 1,000 years by making sure that there is a willing and supportive community who are able to patiently teach and support and share knowledge. So the knitting communities created welcoming spaces where newbies feel welcome and where they're not mocked for answering questions. Yeah, I'm looking at you, Stack Overflow. Most horrible place to ask a question ever if you're new. And these spaces, right, they don't happen by accident. These spaces are deliberately made to ensure the health of the community. So Ravelry has guidance and rules around how you respond to questions. They have moderators who watch. They have the equivalent of a code of conduct, right? So what's the difference in tech and in open source? This was me. So when I was learning to code, it was a really discouraging experience. And it felt like it came from the fact that we compete rather than collaborate a lot of the time. And that drives us towards a contempt culture, right? It drives us towards a culture where we build barriers to entry out of fear. And if you haven't read what the really excellent Oren with the like bluey-green amazing hair has written about this or spoke about this on Monday, you should go and read it, right? Or watch your talk from WorkConf. Much of my early learning experience in coding was bashing up against my own frustration, and I'm sure that most of you felt that too when you were learning to code, or even when you know you're picking up a new framework or anything now. I spent hours and hours trying to solve something that if there'd been a supportive community around me, I could have just asked them a question and it would have been solved within minutes. And if I did ask a question, because I tried, it was met with a flavor of, well, duh, you should know this already. And I'm sitting there going, but how? How am I meant to know this? All of this is like absolute gobbledygook to me. And so it was really lonely, and it was really, really discouraging. And what I've noticed is that it often feels like we glamorize the painful parts of learning and the painful parts of starting up in our industry. We talk about it like we have, you know, war stories, that we survived this and it's made us like harder and better. But we don't really think about the fact that that's really messed up, right? Learning a new skill should not be a really painful experience. Okay, it's actually a sign of a really dysfunctional community and industry if we're wearing that as a badge of honor rather than seeing it as something we need to work on. And so if we want a thriving and welcoming community that's going to last into the future, we need to make a community that creates delightful first experiences. And I'm a UX designer, so I'm all about the delightful experiences, and I'd really like for that to be better. So what can we do about this, right? So if you're in a position, and I think pretty much everybody in our industry is in a position to make things better for new people, there are loads of things we can do. So that includes making it safe to ask questions. So try and remove the fear that people will have of being judged for language choices or text editor choices or newbie screw-ups, like making security mistakes that they don't know about, because how on earth would they know about them? Or, you know, just inelegant code. So don't tolerate hostility when you see it. Call it out. Don't tolerate aggression cultures. And try and remember that newbies asking questions is actually really good for your projects as well. When you have fresh eyes on your project, they bring fresh perspectives. You don't know what background someone is bringing into your project where they can add an awful lot of value. So listen to the questions, encourage them to ask them. You never know what they might say. Try and reduce the barrier to them writing the first line of code. Now, I ran Rails Girls in Auckland, and I can tell you that the install fest for Rails Girls, even with all the instructions written out, is super painful. Like, we turn it into a party and we bring them like cake and fun stuff, and it's still like 3 hours of really, really, really unpleasant experience. And this is the first time that people touch Rails. And that's if they're on Mac. The Windows was even worse, right? Now, I can tell you that for pretty much most people, 3 hours of battling to set up a local dev environment is not a fun time. I know there are some weirdos who really think that that's a good idea and they really enjoy that. I don't really understand you, but I'm going to accept that. But for everybody else, that's something that they don't really want, and that's stopping new people coming into our industry. If you're a maintainer on a project, encourage first PRs. I've talked to a whole bunch of open source maintainers this week, and they're like, yeah, we'd really love new people on our project. I'm like, cool, what are you doing to make it obvious? Right, how are you telling people that they're welcome? There's a really, really great project called Your First PR. I think it's at yourfirstpr.com, that talks about how to signpost things for newbies so that they can search on GitHub and find ways to contribute to your project. Use things like that, right? Make it really obvious, explicitly signpost to newbies that they're welcome in your project. Right? And then when they do, celebrate their success. Okay? Do a really kind code review with them, explain if they've made mistakes, help them through it, and then when it gets merged in, celebrate it. And don't just celebrate it for newbies, celebrate it for people who are experienced in the community too. Right? Open source can be a really thankless place a lot of the time, and we need to recognize the contributions of everybody, both new and old, okay? Positive reinforcement goes a really long way, and people like to pretend they don't need it, but it makes everybody feel better. So the second thing that I learned was that your code is a tool, right? As a designer in tech, observing the work of designers in knitwear taught me that the importance of humility in the service that we provide. So as a knitwear designer, when you make a pattern, and you put it out into the world, you are asking people to spend hours and hours and hours, and I'm talking sometimes 50, 100 hours of their leisure time, knitting your pattern. And when you're asking them to do that, you realize it's not actually about you, right? It's about them. Your code is a tool. And if you're being precious about that, it's a really fast way to do a bad job. You may be making a hugely creative and awesome and exciting thing, right? But unless the patterns or the code that you're creating provide utility to somebody else, they're basically useless. Designers, like coders, like knitwear designers, exist to provide a service to other people, right? We're a service industry. The end user of knitwear projects is a person. Kind of sounding obvious, right? You make a jumper, a person wears it. But because people have different needs, they're different shapes, they're different sizes, they may have allergies to some types of wool, they may have just different preferences. Good knitwear designers, and the best ones are like this, they know that when they write their pattern, it's not just about how elegant and how simple their code is, it's about how well it meets those human needs. So when I'm knitting a pattern, it's those needs that I'm looking for. I want to know whether or not I can easily adapt it to use stripes or different colors. Can I alter it? You know, if I'm knitting it for someone who's tall, can I lengthen the torso and the sleeves really easily? Or can I add a fuller bust adjustment? Can I make a shorter waist? Right? A good designer will think about that stuff. And they don't assume that everyone else's bodies and that everyone else's needs should conform to their own just because they were the one writing the pattern. Okay? They do their craft in service of other people, and they build that into the patterns that they write. Dictatorial patterns suck because we're not one size fits all. Okay? And dictatorial code also sucks. As coders, it's really, really, really easy for us to fall into the trap of assuming that we should get to dictate how everyone else experiences the world, right? We have quite a lot of power. We're the ones who are building all these interfaces that people use. We're designing the database schemas. We get to decide who's included and who isn't included, okay? And it's easy to forget to include people if you're not thinking about the fact that you are there to provide a service to somebody else. So if you find yourself creating arbitrary rules based on what you think people will want to do, pause, right? Ask yourself if this is an anti-pattern. And unless you're facilitating something illegal or something fundamentally insecure, maybe stop and consider whether you could give the users of your code what it is that they want or they need to get things done in their life. Right. Instead of thinking they should want to do it your way, try and understand why they want to do it their way. Okay? Everyone else's need is just as genuine as your own, and just because you haven't experienced their life doesn't mean you shouldn't try and understand it. And the thing is, right, if you don't, users are going to try and create a workaround anyway. And if you have ever designed a product or coded a product or even maintained an open source project, you know how painful it is when people create workarounds and then you change something and they're all like, oh, you broke my entire workflow and you didn't know about it. And those workflows arise because you're not listening to the needs of your users. Now, in case you're wondering what Amy's rant was in relation to, excuse my blanking that out, it's this type of stuff, right? So if you can't read it, it's a magnetic card reader, right? And some UX people put a thing out that says, design play, redraw the little icon so I know how I'm supposed to put my card in. And Amy's rant was, why do I have to know which way I put my card in? Why can't the technology just cater for whatever way I put it in? It's not like magnets are in shortage, right? And it's this type of thinking that we need to do more of in tech. How do we actually make it easier for our users? How do we cater for how they experience the world? And this also applies when it comes to choosing the tools that we use to build our products. Now, if you think that coders obsess over their tool chains, wait until you get a bunch of knitters together, okay? It's ridiculous. They obsess about everything from like the entire production line, like the yak shaving stuff I was talking about before, whether it's synthetic, what dye process was used, like all of that stuff down to the tiniest detail is obsessed about. And as much as anyone, we are susceptible to wanting to use the new shiny, right? We go into shops and we're like, ooh, this feels amazing. It's nice and soft and squishy and I want to buy it and I want to use it. But we have to remember when we knit projects that it's not actually about us entirely, right? And it's not just about the process that we go through, although that's pleasurable too. We have to pick the tools that are about getting the best end result. And some yarns just are not suitable for some types of knitting. So this is an amazing yarn called Fiber Spates, and it's a silk blend yarn, and it's incredible and soft, and you just want to rub your face on it. But if I want to make something like this, which is a colourwork jumper, I need yarn with a high animal fibre content, so it will grip to itself and it will hold the pattern in place. I can't use that shiny yarn. It doesn't matter how much I want to use it, right? I could try, and as I battled to try and force everything into place, it would just keep slipping apart. And the same applies for the code that you write. Okay, I know that all the time we're all like, ooh, new hotness, I want to use microservices, or I want to build a serverless architecture. It's really, really tempting to fall for that, but we have to keep asking ourselves, right, is this the right tool for the job? Is this the tool that's going to deliver the best value for my user? Or am I just doing this because I want to play? Okay, choose the right tool because it's the right tool. So part of building welcoming communities and recognizing that your product is a tool is your documentation. Okay, you have to document for inclusiveness. And by this I mean both your customer-facing documentation and your technical documentation. And I used to write documentation for a living, so I kind of thought that I had this down until I started knitting and I saw some of the approaches that they used. When we write documentation, we bring with us all of the assumptions and prior knowledge that we carry into the writing process unless we're really careful. So sometimes we forget that the focus should be on helping the person succeed, okay? Rather than just stopping people from asking us questions, which is what most documentation's written for. It's a question deferment strategy. And it means that a lot of the time, right, we leave out important details that could help somebody who's new to the code to succeed. And so when you're writing documentation, it can be really helpful to take a step back and think, what are all the questions that a newbie is going to have? And there are lots of different aspects to this, so I'm just going to run through this, how I'd approach knitting documentation. So the first thing I ask is, what even is this thing, right? People forget this all the time. They're so familiar with the context of their project that they forget that when someone new is coming to it, that they don't tell them what it is. Right? As a knitter, the first thing I want to know when I look at a project is, well, I want to see pictures of it, I want to see a description of it, I want to see how other people have made the same thing. I want to see how it looks in the real world. So marketers talk about social proof, which is a way of giving people confidence in the fact that what you've built is useful for their own use case, and this is a similar type of concept, right? It's helping people to understand what you have created is useful for them. So on Ravelry, this is from Ravelry, you can see the same pattern in a whole range of different implementations. You can see everybody who has chosen to share their project. So I can see it in different sizes and colors and adaptations. I can see notes people have left. I can see if the community has told me that they're going to be helpful to me, and I can filter by that. Now, I think the same should apply for code, whether that's open source code or whether you work on a product. I want you to tell me what your code does. Show me how it's used, okay? I want to know what things people have done with your code. If you know projects that people have used that have incorporated your project, tell me about them. If they've written about the experience, if they've written a really great blog post about using your project, link me to it. I want to learn from their experience. These are all things you can do to make it easier for people to understand if your project is suitable for them. The next thing I want to know if I'm looking at a knitting pattern is, am I good enough to do this, right? Am I capable of creating this? So while knitting's fundamentally based on two stitches, your knit stitch and your purl stitch, there are many, many complex skill sets that are derived from that simple base. So you've got cables, and you've got lace, and you've got colour work, and you've got steeking. Now, steeking is where you actually cut your work in half, and so if you think database sharding is scary, let me tell you, wait until you take a pair of scissors to something you spent 50 hours knitting. It is absolutely petrifying. So on Ravelry, patterns have this, right? Seems simple. It's a difficulty rating and a quality rating. And it indicates, for me as a user, how hard this pattern is to do, and also how well constructed the pattern is based on community feedback. More realistically, it also gives me an indication personally of how frustrated I should expect to get when I'm implementing this. Now, this is really, really useful if you're a newbie to a craft, whether it's coding, whether it's knitting, because you're gonna head up against frustrations as you learn. And it's a really helpful check to know, well, have other people found this difficult? Should I find this hard? You know, I know I'm only new to this, and this is rated at like, you know, 3 bars out of 10, so it's probably gonna be a little challenging for me. I should persist, or maybe I should ask the community for help. It's a good calibration. So once I have an idea of what it does and whether it's within my skill set, I actually need to understand if it meets my detailed requirements. So in terms of knitting, this is your sizing stuff, right? For a garment, it's vital to know if a pattern is graded up to fit my size. Okay? I could scale it up myself, I've been knitting for a while now, but that's a risk, right? That's untested code. So what I'm looking to figure out here is if the pattern is fit for purpose, if it meets my user needs. So when you're crafting your documentation, it's really important to identify any limitations in your code or in your product that would prevent the reader from achieving success. Don't make them download your code, don't make them do an installation before they find out that there's some caveat buried like 20 lines deep. Tell them up front. Okay? Anything less than that is disrespectful and it wastes their time. And it also wastes your time. Okay? Because these are the people who are going to complain on social media. They're going to open tickets. They're going to put issues on your issue tracker, right? Be honest and upfront about the limitations of what your code does. Okay? If you can be more inclusive, be more inclusive. But it's better to be honest about the shortcomings than it is to mislead people and waste their time, right? And if you identify issues where you think you could be more inclusive, then it gives you a really good backlog of features to start adding or additions to start expanding your project with. So in terms of knitting, I know then, okay, I know what it is, I know that it meets my requirements, I know that this is something I want to make. And once I'm there, I want to know what I actually need to do this. Okay, so what are the tools I need? So like, kind of like mise en place and cooking, getting everything set up to start with is vital to the success of both a coding project and a knitting project. It helps make your process really smooth and so you don't get roadblocks and frustrations and you're less likely to abandon it. So knitting your equipment is needles and yarn, but also any other notions like buttons and zips and blocking equipment and darning needles and other finishing things. So for things that can be substituted, like your yarn, they provide enough details to tell you how to substitute it, right? They help you to make the right decision. They tell you the fiber blends, they tell you how many yards per 100 grams. And we've also got tools on things like Ravelry that help newbies and experienced knitters to make the right decisions for the things that can be substituted. So you notice there it tells me what the suggested yarn is, and then it tells me that in my stash that I actually have a yarn that I can use for this project. Right? It's reducing the barrier to entry for me immediately by saying, you can start knitting this now. Right? It's doing a system check for me, basically. So the analogy to coding is pretty simple, right? Tell the users, be they of your open source project or something else, what they need to have at hand to be successful. Okay? Don't make assumptions that they're going to know. So the one that I showed you before, this one, you'll notice at the bottom the sewing needle and matching thread. Now, that seems pretty obvious, right? At the end of a project, you're going to need to sew it up. But that is on every single knitting pattern. Okay? And the reason that it's there is because you never know if this is going to be a newbie's first pattern. They don't necessarily know that that's what they need. And there's nothing worse than getting to the end of a project and finding out you don't have the vital last piece of equipment that you need. So include it. It doesn't cost you anything to tell people exactly in detail what it is that they need. And even if it's not newbies, right, you reduce the cognitive load that people have to carry by specifying that. They don't have to remember it in their head. You've written it out on a bit of paper for them. Be kind to your users. Right, so you know, for your project, if they need to install Homebrew, don't assume that everyone's got it. Tell them that, right, if it's going to need to be there. Do they need a specific version of like Python or Ruby or whatever? Tell them. Be specific. Don't just tell them, though. Link them to the place they can get it, right? If somebody is new, they're not going to know where to go and get that. You know without even thinking. So tell them. Easy for you, hard for them. So there's one other thing that knitting pattern designers do, right, that's a little bit special. So I'm going to show you from the pattern itself. It's a thing called gauge. You might be wondering what gauge is, right? So gauge is how many stitches you get in a square, and it's called a gauge swatch. And every pattern will tell you what the gauge is. And the reason that we do this is that it turns out that you can give two knitters identical needles and identical yarn and the same pattern, and the end result will be different. Okay? This is because, funnily enough, people are not identical. Okay? Revelation. But it means that when we do knitting, we carry ourselves into our work, right? So we carry the way that we were taught, we carry the stresses that we hold in our body, we carry our level of experience. All of that can come into our work and it can create bias. So to counter this bias, knitters realized that we needed to create a test, right? We needed a way for all of us to align ourselves so that we could get the desired outcome. We wanted everybody to be successful, so we needed a way to mitigate our bias. So the person who writes the pattern records the gauge that they knit at, and they record the needle sizes that they used, and they record the yarn that they used. And this is included in the pattern. And then before other knitters start the pattern, they knit a gauge swatch too, and they measure it. And if it matches, they know that they're good to start the pattern. And if it doesn't match, they try a different needle size, and they keep doing that until they've got the right thing. They're countering the bias. Now, we don't have anything like that in coding, right? We don't communicate anything about our identity and the assumptions that we make when we start coding when we share our code. Okay? And beyond hoping that whoever does a code review picks it up, and given the diversity in our industry, right, most of the time that's not going to happen. So you want to try and get a code review done by someone who doesn't look like you. Or you want to try and get beta testers involved in your project who have different life experiences to you. Right? The dangerous thing with biases is that we can't see them. So to me, my knitting is perfectly normal, right? And I know from gauge swatching that I need to go up two needle sizes for every pattern. Turns out that I hold all my stress in my hands. Now, what do you think that is normal about the way that you live that is actually not, right? You don't know what is not a shared experience. The other thing is that the way that we communicate information is just as important as the content, right? So knitted patterns come in multiple forms. They come in written ones, and they come in charts. And knitting patterns also have tests throughout them. So there are multiple layers of unit tests within a pattern. There are things that tell you that you need to do this until the end of the row, and then it tells you the number of stitches. There are garment schematics that are given, right? All of these things help knitters to have a check as they go through the pattern to know, am I on the right track? So this is kind of like the knitted version of test-driven development. And this helps dramatically if you are tired and you are new and you don't know what the heck you're doing. Right, this helps you from making too many mistakes. And it's little considerations like that about how other people's brains work that can help make all the difference. And so this is a lacework chart, and this is provided as an alternate form in documentation to written ones. Now, I'm a lacework knitter. I prefer working off charts. I have friends who cannot use them. Right? And when you think about writing your documentation, providing things in multiple forms helps to cater for different learning styles. So this is a pretty long way from where most of our docs are today. Okay, most of our docs are purely writing, maybe some diagrams. We're not thinking about illustrations and videos and many other forms that we could really incorporate. And I know that there's a lot of overhead into doing that, but there are lots and lots of people who have those skills who'd like to be part of our community and feel like they're not welcome. So talk about it if you want those skills. Those people are more than likely happy to contribute if you say that you value their work and if you provide a space for them to do so. So the last lesson I want to talk to you about is the true cost of fixing your mistakes. It's really important that you understand this. And as I mentioned, hand knitting is a really slow craft, like super slow. It can take you 50 hours to knit like a jumper, right? It's a lot of time. It's also why knitters will always give you kind of a stink eye if you say, hey, can you make me a jumper? And we're like, yeah, nah. Right, but when you're working that slow, right, it makes you think really carefully about how you approach error handling. So my worst error, I missed an increase in the bit at the start of the pattern, right, on the 10th row. The shawl was constructed from the centre out. And a centre out construction means that the mistake that you make very early on is multiplied handily throughout the pattern. And I got up to the row with the zigzag, and I counted the zigzags, and I realised I'd missed an entire section. And I was like, crap. And I had to frog it, right? Frogging is a technique in knitting where you basically pull the entire thing back. And I can tell you that is heartbreaking. But it wasn't all bad, right? When I re-knit it, I was much faster, because this was my first lace project, and my work was much better because I'd learned from the mistakes that I'd made. And I was happier because I got to go back and fix all the tiny niggles that I'd learned as I went along. Right, but frogging isn't the only solution. So there's two factors kind of at play when a knitter tries to decide whether they go back and bug fix. So the first is, right, once the garment is finished, you cannot go back and fix it, right? If you, like, cast it off, it's done. So the other factor is that there's time involved, right? Pulling back your work, as I said, takes a long time, and it's a long time to fix all of those things. So you have to be really ruthless and also really practical when you're assessing that. So what this is about is the sunk cost fallacy, okay? And it's about how you deal with sunk costs. So there's two things that we start with when we're thinking about this in a knitting context. So one is, does the bug impact the final outcome of the work in a significant way? Now, I'm a perfectionist by nature. I let that go real fast, right? You cannot continue to be a perfectionist in this context, right? If it doesn't change the fit, the shape, massively change the pattern, then you let it go, right? Sometimes it's just not worth fixing it. If it's not a major bug, you can just let it go sometimes. If it is, then you're gonna fix it, right? And sometimes though, if it doesn't have one of those impacts and it can be fixed in less than 30 minutes, that's my personal criteria, and fixing it will greatly improve my happiness, then I'll fix it. Once I've decided to fix it though, right, there are three options for me to fix it. So I can drop down in the rows. So if you think about a knitted garment as like a series of rows that build up, you can drop down an individual stitch or two stitches and then fix it in and pull it back up, right? It's kind of like doing a little bit of a bug patch, and you can do that without much cost and without much time spent. But you can't do that on complex lace patterns, you can't do that on things that expand outward, you can't do that on cables, there's a whole bunch of things that you can't do it on. So a second option is to do what we call tinking back, which is actually where you undo the stitches one by one. So this is frustrating, it's painstaking, it takes a long time, but it gets the job done, right? This is like if you have to delete a little bit of your code and rework it, you're like, this kind of sucks, but I'm gonna do it anyway, right? But for both of these, when I'm knitting, I time box it. And if I'm spending more than 30 minutes, stop and reassess. And instead, frog, right? This is frogging. This is my friend's sock that she pulled apart. This is the nuclear option. It's really fun. And you do this when you realize that actually your mistake is not able to be recovered. And sometimes it's just better to do this and let it go, okay? So the things that you can learn from this is commit early and commit often, which hopefully you know already, and knitters do this with a thing called lifelines. But more importantly, be really realistic about the cost to actually stopping and fixing your mistakes. Right? You actually gain quite a lot from starting fresh. You learn from all of the mistakes that you made, and be realistic about the time it will take you to fix it versus what you'll gain from starting afresh. As I said, let it go. So those are the four lessons I think you can take away. There are, of course, more than them, but you need to probably start knitting and try and learn some of them for yourself. But I want to loop back around to history for just one moment, all right? There's one important reason why some of the lessons learned in knitting are ones that you should take to heart. So the Luddite movement, if you're familiar with it, opposed automation in the industrial age. Now, we're getting kind of familiar with the perils of automation right now. And some of the roots of the Luddite movement were opposing the development of automated knitting machines, because the craftspeople saw them as something that they were going to destroy their way of life and change the face of it. So knitting has persisted despite all of that, and despite people saying ever since then that it's a dying craft that needs to go away. And it continues to inspire generations of people, including people like, you know, the Aiders and the Belgian Resistance and people like me, right? And I want to see coding still be like that in 1,000 years' time, right? Knitting has survived. I want coding to too. And so I think that we need to nail some of these things. Thank you.
time for some questions. Anyone have any?
Oh, hi, Nat. You know, in Ravelry, they don't seem to have a version control system at all. Would you think that they it would help or not?
I think so, but I think also it's one of those things we have to balance up the capability of the community versus the technology implementation. And a lot of the people writing patterns are used to the form that they're writing them in. And so I think long term, it would be really great to have like a full-on version control system, but that would require quite a lot of infrastructure change in terms of the people who are writing it. If something like NitML, which Chris talked about in her talk on Monday, came in, then I think it'd be a lot easier to transition to that. But until then, it's the balance of community needs versus, you know, technological capability. And in the meantime, the versioning of the patterns that comes out, like I have versioned patterns that have been released, that seems to do an okay job.
Yeah, I was just curious about frogging. Is there a story behind that word? Or
so Nit is really like puns. Frogging comes because you're talking about ripping it back, and they're saying rip it, rip it.
You mentioned the advantage of having documentation in multiple different formats, and you had the text notation and the pictures.
Yep.
Are there any tools to turn one into the other?
Yes. Chris talked about it in her talk on Monday. So there are some tools for designers where they can feed in the written instructions that they've written, and it creates charts for them. So there's a whole bunch of interesting tech that helps pattern designers that help to generate those things. So yeah, those things do exist.
Got time for one more?
That was great, Nat. I love that example on the Ravelry of the difficulty of the project, and I was just thinking, my God, if that was on GitHub, I would have saved so many hours of trying
to. Me too.
Have you seen anything like that, or is anyone trying to do something like that? I just thought that was
I
awesome.
I haven't. It's one of the things that I wish existed. I'm hoping that with GitHub's newer focus on community and like inclusion, that maybe some of those features will start to be thought about a bit more. I know that they've kind of changed some of their focus recently, so fingers crossed.
Okay, lovely. Now, thank you, Nat. On behalf of the LCA team, we have a token of their appreciation
Thank you.
For your work. Everybody, thank you.